Hey guys, this week's show features Gigi Pedron. She's a lighting director, and I was so blown away by the work she did on the recent Failure Swerve Driver tour that I had to invite her on the show. She's worked with Queens and a Prince, and has done some amazing work with people like Jack White, Garbage, Bikini Kill, and the list goes on and on. She describes a lot about her work, how she makes art out of light, and what busking is. So please enjoy this week's episode with Gigi Pedron. Follow her at Gigi Lights on social media, gigilights.com. Follow us at Performance ANX on Twitter and Instagram. Go to performanceanx.threadless.com and buy things. All right, enjoy this week's show.
Okay. Hi, my name is Gigi. I'm a lighting designer. And I'm here on the Performance Anxiety. It's so hard to say. performance Anxiety. Oh my God, with my friend, it's so hard to say.
All right, so how have you been, by the way?
Well, very, very busy. It's my only day off, the first day off in 9 days, and my only day off in 2 weeks, so.
Oh my gosh. Well, I promise I won't keep you all night.
No, please. Yeah, it really is my only day off.
Oh my gosh. Well, I really do appreciate you taking some time on your only day off to talk to me.
I'm so sorry. I had to push back so many times.
No. But,
you know, it's just.
You've got to work.
It's been crazy, yeah. It's been crazy.
Well, I mean, you're working with some amazing people. And, you know, you go right from the Failure tour straight to Bikini Kill and God knows what's next. I mean, it's.
Garbage.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Garbage is awesome. I bet you Priscilla's thrilled to hear that.
Oh, yeah. She's a good friend with Shirley.
Priscilla's awesome. I love her to death. Yeah. She's so cool. All right. So you're the lighting director, and we met briefly right after the Failure show at the 930 Club, very briefly. All we ended up doing was actually talking about how much we didn't like Pearl Jam anymore. So
yes.
So you've been a lighting director for, was it 17 or 18 years now?
19 years.
19 years.
Yeah.
Oh, my. So how did you get into this profession? Was that what you started off wanting to do, or is that something that you just fell into?
It was something I fell into, but mostly I'm a music fan. And I was, since I'm a kid, listened to music and went to shows. Since being a teenager and being able to like go places by myself, I would go every weekend to shows, several shows, festivals. And, you know, that was music always was what driven me, and music and art, because actually I studied art. I graduated in a fine art school in France.
Okay.
And, I love art and I love music. So what's the link between all that? And I just discovered that lighting was like by accident almost. I was like, I went to a venue and I saw the lighting guy doing lights, and I just figured out that it's a thing. It was a job, you know.
Yeah.
I had no idea before that. From like the first minute, I was like, oh, I want to do this. I want to paint music. You know? So
what was the plan when you were in college? Because you studied, you got a degree in art expression.
Art expression and history of contemporary art. Yeah.
Okay. So the plan obviously at that point was not necessarily to become a lighting director for some of the coolest artists on the planet, but, you must've had something else in mind. What was your plan going into art school?
Really no plan. You can't really plan to become an artist. You can't really plan on a career based on art. You know, I would say it's more finding yourself and whatever you need to express yourself. You know, some people are drawing, some people are videographers, some people are photographers, some people are sculptors, and it happens that I'm a lighting person.
Right. Well, yeah. And you've done some amazing work. Now, you said that you went to a show and you discovered what a lighting director was. You saw somebody working the lights at a show. And how did you go from being just an attendee at a concert to getting into designing lights for bands?
Well, after that, I was like, oh, cool. Lighting looks cool. I want to do that. So I went to see a band in my hometown that I knew, you know, very small hometown in France. And it was like a pretty successful rock ska band at the time.
Okay.
And I had an internship to do for my my university, as you call that, you know, my art mm-hmm. school.
Right, right.
And I was like, okay, well, can I do my internship with you? And they're like, well, we get a tour. So that's perfect. And and like, well, we don't have money to pay you. And I'm like, well, I don't know what I'm doing. So yeah. it's fair game.
Yeah.
You know?
Hey.
Yeah. First of all, I discovered the touring world. Then I validated my internship. So it's good for my degree. And I learned something new. And I get to be, you know, on a van with a band and go on the road. So. That's pretty fair. Yeah, I was 19, 20. I was 20.
Wow. Oh, my God, 20. I was, gosh, I was probably sleeping through one of my classes in Rochester, New York at 20. Yeah. So you became an intern doing the lighting. And what was your first real paying gig that you did as a lighting director?
Well, the same band. Like just after my internship.
Oh, okay.
Stick with them as long as they wanted me for, you know?
Okay.
And then on the road, I met another band while doing lighting for this band. And they're like, oh, we got a tour coming. And I did that tour. And that tour was my first tour bus tour, actually.
Oh, wow.
And then, you know, doing lighting for that band and another band and another band. And that's it. I've been on the tour bus for 19 years. I went basically from like art school to a tour bus, and I've never stopped since.
Oh my gosh, and you've done the lighting for some amazing people. I've got a list here, and I'll tell you just to let the listeners know, because this list is amazing. You've been the lighting director for Beck, Sonic Youth, Weezer, Prince, Failure, Autolux, Ryan Adams, Jesus and Mary Chain, Foster the People, Rival Schools, Father John Misty, Alan Johannes, let's see, and a band I've never heard of, but for some reason the name just really intrigues me, Grim Skunk.
Yeah, they're a French-Canadian band.
Okay.
They're punk rock, and they're pretty, badass.
Yeah. I'm going to have to check them out, because that's just a great name. Mm. So how did...
I'm going to have to clarify your list there because...
Oh, yeah, please.
Because there is two parts of my job.
Okay.
There's a part where I do a design for a band, operate the lighting during the show, and go with them on tour.
Okay.
There's also shows that I replace someone that's not available that I didn't design myself.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
So, for example, Beck, you cited Beck. I cannot say I am the lighting designer for Beck. I did shows doing the light for Beck when their LD was not available, not under my design.
Ah, okay. Okay.
Doesn't change the fact I did the lights
right.
for several shows, but it's not my own lighting design, this particular example.
Okay.
But the list of my own design is also pretty extensive. But yeah, that's what it is. So I did lighting design per se for Queen of the Stone Age, the last tour, Villain World Tour. Tegan and Sarah, lighting design for Jack White, lighting design for At the Drive-In and Failure and so many other bands.
So what goes into designing the lights for a concert, for a tour, I guess? What do you sit down with the band, you know, weeks ahead of time and just figure out what their desire is, and you just go ahead and do it? Or are you guys planning out each song, or how does the whole thing work? How do you get it to work so well?
Well, it really depends on what artist you're working with.
Okay.
Usually when a band reached out to me for their design, I do a search on them to see what universe they want to represent. Then we got to talk, and then I give a design, a proposition, you mean, you know, like renders.
Right, right.
Most of the band I've been working with, like I would say 99% of the band I worked with, give me full confidence.
Okay, so
I rarely had to sit with an artist song by song. This is not the type of clientele I have. Right. And it's not the type of LD I am either.
So when you're designing for band, let's say like Queens of the Stone Age, and you don't have to sit with them song by song, but do they tell you what songs they're going to be playing on tour and you work around that? Do you have to see them?
It really depends. It really depends. Again, it really depends. Some band, for example, Queen of the Stone Age would change the set list pretty much every night or not following it. They have seven or eight records out, and they are free to play any songs they want. Jack White didn't give me a set list, never. He doesn't do that.
Okay.
So all the shows are just listen and go with the flow.
So you're kind of improvising along with the band then?
Yeah. Yeah. Huh? Yeah.
That's amazing.
Definitely when it's more of a jam band. Some band play also electronic music on tracks, and it's always the same tempo and everything.
Okay.
So there's, you know, every band is different. Some people work on the same set list every night for efficiency. Some people like to have fun with it and mix it around. It's just more fun for me.
So I've heard, and you may have, you're gonna have to explain this part to me, because I was reading up on what you do to try to understand a little bit more about it while we talk. And I read the term busking while you're doing your writing show. Can you kind of explain to me what that is?
Busking is operating the lighting live instead of having like a cue sheet. Exactly, a cue stack.
Okay.
Busking is having a lot of stuff on your console and feel it, you know?
So you're just kind of reacting to the band. You're basically almost playing another instrument because you're just following what the band does and reacting and doing your lighting to the move that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
That is the fact that you can do something like that and do it so well, that's amazing to me.
It's again, it's a different style. Lighting as all of styles, you know, we all are, every LD have different way of doing things.
Right.
Yeah. You know, we also have like a different clientele, different aesthetic.
Where do you get inspiration? Like for example, on Jack White's tour, you were the director, the lighting director for his Lazaretto tour.
I did the Lazaretto and the Blunderbuss.
Okay.
The tour before Blunderbuss.
Yeah. Okay, great. Oh, awesome. I know that the Lazaretto tour, you were limited to just using the color blue. Was that your decision or was that something Jack wanted?
No, that was something Jack wanted.
Okay. How do you find inspiration when you've got a narrow set of parameters, like you just have to use blue?
Well, it's for me, it triggers my creative process, you know. I love challenges like this. It's be able to set just one color but have the intensity of a rock show. It's not easy to do. I don't like easy.
Right, exactly.
You know?
So having tight parameters can actually force you to be more creative.
Yeah, completely. Yeah.
And I know I've seen some shows where there are video screens and all. Do you deal with any of that?
That's not my thing.
Okay.
Per se, I'm not a big a video person. I think it distracts from the band, and I that's not my style. I've been using projections. I like video projectors because they're light source.
Yeah, no, that makes sense.
But for my clientele and the lights, the design I've been doing, I don't need video. This is for a different kind of production, I believe. you know, DJs, electronic music,
right, yeah.
pop music, all that. It makes sense for it to have a video, but not, you know, at the drive-in or Queen of the Stone Age or right. Failure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm doing Bikini Kill right now. Certainly not a video.
Right. Exactly.
Especially not. Jack White didn't want a video either. It's a different genre, I would say, of the work.
And have you ever felt like you run the risk of maybe being, how to put this, instead of overshadowing the band, maybe? Is it a hard line to straddle being interesting without taking away from the band's performance?
Yeah. No, I think lighting is to enhance a performance. You know,
yeah.
You should not like that. For me, it's very subtle. That's why I don't use lasers or confettis or video or anything, because, you know, there's no need when you get a good band on stage.
Right. Exactly. You just want to enhance the experience.
Yes, and that's the experience. And also, I basically only accept gig that I like the music and that I back up the project behind it. You know, if tomorrow a band that's massive and I don't like call me to do the lights, I will be saying no.
So Pearl Jam calls you up tomorrow and you're like, no.
I would say no. Yeah, I would say no.
Do you find that you have to get new equipment with bands? Because I saw on the Queens of the Stone Age Villains tour, you had these LED mm-hmm. lights that look like panels going. But you know, I didn't see that on the Failure tour or some other things.
No, it's custom. It was made only. I do not recycle my designs.
Oh, okay. Wow.
Everything like the Failure tour you saw, that design with Failure is the only time that you're gonna see it.
Oh,
you know, if
gosh.
You do another tour with another something else, it's going to be a different design.
Oh, wow. So what do you do with stuff after you use it like that?
Oh, it's rental. It's rental.
Oh, okay. See, that's good. I'm glad to hear that, because I'm sitting there going, holy God, this poor woman's going to be shelling out bucks for this stuff. Never use it again. Jeez.
No. It's rental. Come on.
Yeah. Well, see, this is why I want to talk to people who do this amazing work, because I don't know how this stuff works. You know, I don't know what you need to do to prepare, but it's fascinating to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a collaboration between a lot of different people. You know, you get the financial part, which is more management and like budget manager. You get the lighting design per se. You get the lighting rental companies.
Okay.
Trusting rental companies, the audio renting companies, the set renting companies, you know, it's a lot of different work coming together for one project.
So does the size of the venue play a big part in designing the show?
Oh, yes, definitely. You need to know what you're going to need and what for and where.
Right, because I can imagine the Queens of the Stone Age tour wouldn't have done as... You wouldn't really have been able to do it at like the 9:30 club or...
Oh, yeah, we would be able to.
Oh, really?
Smaller, it's easier.
Oh, okay, because it looked like it's a massive setup to do...
Oh, we can always get down, you know?
Ah, okay.
Always get down. We adapt to the venue. The opposite is a big... it's a bigger issue.
Oh,
for
really?
Example, on the Queen of the Stone Age tour, it was early during the tour, so I didn't add the entire lighting, right? We were building up as we go,
okay.
You know, per period of touring, so adding more and more and more. But we played at a massive venue in France called Bercy in Paris, and very early during the tour, and it was not enough light for that gigantic place.
Oh, wow.
Period was the first very, very bad review of my work in the press. And it took me so long to get over it. Because I rarely have bad reviews. But when I do and it's in France, it's very, very hard to take.
I can imagine.
The thing is that we were playing smaller size venues. So the lighting rig was, you know, adapted to that. And in the middle of it, a gigantic one.
Oh,
which,
God.
You know, that's the way it is. So
I wanted to ask you about touring with some of these bands in particular. What was your job, I guess, when you were touring with Prince? Were you the lighting director or were you filling in for somebody like you had mentioned earlier?
Yeah. Well, this is Prince was a different animal because it's a big revolving crew.
Okay.
but at the time I was there to replace his LD at the time, Charles, amazing guy. He was doing a few shows with Carly Rae Jepsen at the time. And he's like, well, I can't be here. So will you be able to do it? And I came back and stayed after that, even with Charles. And we run the show with both console, the two of us. So, yeah.
Oh, wow.
But yeah, Prince was a different animal. He would do his lighting design by himself.
Really? One
day he would show up and say, I don't want anything in the air. Everything on the floor. Okay. So it was you know, it was his show.
Right, yeah. And he was Prince.
Whatever he wants.
Yeah, exactly. I ain't calling Prince for nothing.
So there you go, you know. It was more, you don't call it lighting designer. At this point, you call it lighting director.
Okay. Now, your first tour in America was with Jimmy Eat World.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And at that time, you didn't know a whole lot of English, right?
Not much, no. I mean,
was it difficult?
A little bit that I learned at school, but yeah. that was a little different than being on the tour bus and doing my lighting job in English. I didn't know the technical world.
Right. Okay. Was it very difficult to communicate the ideas back and forth with those guys at that point?
Well, not the band. I would say not the band, but the local crew. You know, when you do tours and you have a gear and you show up in some region of America where I couldn't understand a word of what they were saying to me.
Oh, yeah.
And the reverse was true, too, you know?
Yeah.
They couldn't understand me at all. So let's say I learned English very fast.
Oh, yeah. Baptism by fire, kind of.
Yeah, exactly. A lot of swear words.
Well, those are good to learn early.
Yeah, get that out of the way.
Yeah. Exactly. All right, so how has lighting changed a lot in the 18, 19 years you've been doing this?
The
technology of it?
Oh, yeah, completely. I was doing rehearsals and I set up a 3D lighting suite to program my lighting, my virtual lighting. And I struggled with IP addresses. I didn't have to struggle with 10 years ago. We didn't have IP addresses in the lighting world, you know, turn the light on and like do the thing and turn the light off. But now in order for the lights, that is a super intelligent robot to communicate, and it's to go, you know, it's now you're an IT person more than a lighting person. This is my biggest frustration.
Oh, I can imagine. I have problems with stuff like that just on my home computer. I can't imagine a lighting rig where you've got either 10, 12 or more lights just all with their own brains.
Oh yeah, sometimes they really don't want to play the game.
Is there anything new on the horizon that you've seen that looks really interesting that can add to the concert experience in your world?
In lighting?
Yeah.
Well, you know.
Without giving away future secrets.
No, I don't think. Well, LED was a big revolution, you know, RGB white LED.
Yeah.
It's not new now, but it's still a big revolution for us, not to having incandescent light and lamps and heavy power consumption. And, you know, those LED lights are amazing.
Yeah.
So for me, that's you can turn them into whatever, too. They're doing LED lasers now.
Jeez.
So it's like, LED is the, it's already the future of lighting, but like we're getting towards full LED.
Well, I went to college back in the early 90s, and I was a photography major. So whenever we needed to change lights, we were using gels and filters and all kinds of
stuff. Yeah, yeah.
You guys, with the LED lights and everything the way it is now, you don't have to use any of that stuff anymore, do you?
Not anymore, no.
That's it. It's just all programmed on your console?
Exactly, yeah,
wow.
Yeah. Yeah, they're all robots. They all have a brain. They all have many possibilities, and they can mix an infinite amount of color.
That's just amazing to me.
Yeah.
I remember, you know, the gels catching fire because the lights got too hot.
Yeah, exactly. You know? Now you don't have to burn yourself focusing light because you know, it's LED, it doesn't get warm either.
Yeah, exactly. That's amazing. That to me is truly insane. Now,
and the weight, you know, it's considerably less heavy.
Oh, wow.
You get less power demand, it's less heavy.
That's a good point.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I remember having to carry, you know, big, huge lights and monolights and all, and they were just enormous and heavy, and power supplies for those, you know, enormous batteries that I'm carrying around for studio shots.
Yeah, and not anymore.
That's, oh man. See, I was in it at the wrong time.
Yeah. Exactly.
I got out of it too fast.
They have like DMX wireless now, so you don't, I mean, it's still work in progress. It's not 100% reliable, but
right.
It's working there towards that. And, you know, what my wish for lighting, if I had one,
yes,
is that going back to the time of Tesla and let him invent power without cables, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Because that's the main thing. Even though now lighting, it's LED, so it's way less power and way less cable. It's still way too much cable.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Now, you mentioned that you rent a lot of the lights, but is...
Mm-hmm.
You run with the same console. Is that the only piece of equipment that you actually have and keep and take everywhere with you, or is there more?
No, this is my tool. This is my instrument.
God.
That's my instrument, yeah.
That's
I can have anything else. This is my, you know, it's my keyboard, my guitar, whatever.
Yeah.
It's my instrument. Yeah.
I got a chance to watch you work a little bit in DC, and it was mm-hmm. amazing. You were just dialed in on the band, and it was just for doing it all live without having a cue sheet and timers or anything. It was the show was magnificent, and I wanted to thank you for just Failure is one of those bands that I wanted to see since back in the 90s, and I never got a chance to see, and I finally got a chance to see them, and it was even more incredible because of the show that you helped to put on. So,
thank you.
I wanted to thank you for the amazing because I'm not exaggerating one bit when I say it was probably the best concert I've ever seen.
Oh, wow!
So,
oh, wow!
It was, and I saw Pearl Jam once, so it was much better than that.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Now, awesome.
Do you play any instruments at all?
No, I play the lighting console.
Well, I see a guitar in the background there.
Yeah. Well, yeah, it's just I'm terrible at every instrument. For a reason, the only thing I can do rhythmically is doing lighting because, you know, I can't play, I can't sing, I can't dance. But I'm always on cue for lighting for a reason. My hands are and my brains, but the rest is not.
Well, I'm in the same boat. I can't. I pretend to play guitar, and I don't even try to sing. But I love my camera, and I love trying to document bands the best I can. And I think some of the shots that I got were because of your lighting were just so dramatic, and it was just. Really can't say enough about the entire experience. Now, is there social media accounts or a website where people can find out who you've worked with in the past and maybe who you're working with?
Yeah. Actually, I have a website. I don't maintain it too well because I don't have time. But I do have a website, gglights.com.
Well, you're never home, so how the heck can you update it?
Well, I can update it on my laptop, but, you know, like, when I have 2 hours during the day between soundcheck and dinner, I'll go sleep.
Well, yeah. I was trying to give you an excuse, but that's all right.
But, yeah. I'll definitely keep up with that. But, yeah, that's my, my most current website.
Is there a – are there social media accounts? Now, if people post pictures of the shows that you're on – Where can they tag you on it? Do you mind if they tag you on pictures?
No, I don't mind. I have an Instagram account. Right. Gigi Lights. Same what? Thing. GIGILIGHTS. Gigi with multiple lights. I usually have multiples.
All right.
That's it. I'm not a social media animal. I don't really post often, but you know, like once a week probably post a picture in there and yeah.
I really encourage people to try to keep an eye on find out where you're going to be, who you're working with, because you've done some of the greatest performances that I've been to. And in doing the research, you know, I unfortunately didn't get a chance to see the Queens of the Stone Age tour or Jack White, but I did get to go back and look at some of the videos, and it was really astounding. The lighting, it was, the art that goes into it is one of the reasons why I definitely wanted to have you on the show and talk to you about where you get this creative energy, this creative voice in something that most people wouldn't think could be that creative.
Yeah, true. Well, it's just my way of expressing myself, you know. I need it out of me. I need to do it. It's like right. People that write, people that paint, people that film. I need that to be fulfilled in order to be happy. it's the creative process in me needs to be out. Otherwise, it drives me crazy.
Are you one of those people that feel satisfied with the show, or are you always nitpicking what you're doing?
Oh, no, I'm never satisfied. So, I have never said there's always a reason not to, you know?
Yeah.
But for me, the lighting rock shows especially was a calling made in heaven, because I didn't even know until last year. I found some article about it, but I have some condition. I'm not going to call it condition, but something called chromesthesia.
Okay.
Which I was born that way. When I hear music, I know I hear shapes and colors.
Okay. So the...
It instantly makes sense to me when I hear music. It's like it goes through me. That's why I busk the shows, because when I hear it, the vibe of it, or the I don't even know how to explain it. It's
when you hear music, you get a visual input.
Yeah, it's more complicated than it's not a clear visual, but it's
right.
I know the color. I know the shape of it.
It's, okay.
Just a little weird to explain.
I think I kind of understand what you're saying. It kind of makes sense to me.
It does have a this condition. Again, it's not a condition, but this thing have a different variance. Some people see color with numbers.
So
yeah.
Oh, that's
chromesthesia.
Chromesthesia.
Yeah, I didn't even know it was a thing. I thought, you know, everybody had some kind of. Quirks. Everybody got quirks, and that was mine.
And
I didn't know it would come so handy.
Well, exactly. You turned it into a career.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I know I'm keeping you quite a while here, so I'll let you go in a minute. But I wanted to know if there's any artists out there that you haven't had a chance to work with that you'd really like to.
Of course, I do have like Arielle Stark. I do have a list.
Yo, you got your list. All right, who tops that list?
The top of the list right now, as of now, I would say Nine Inch Nails.
Ah, excellent.
Uh-huh. Inch Nails. And then just after that, it would be Faith No More.
Oh, wow.
Because Faith No More, and also because Mike Patton. I never worked with Mike Patton, any of his projects. He does have so many projects, and I'm a big fan of his.
Yes.
Never got to work with him yet, so he's on my list.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. I can absolutely see... You working with both of those guys, that would be incredible, particularly Nine Inch Nails. I can definitely see you working with Trent Reznor and doing an amazing job.
Yeah, I think we could collaborate quite well with the aesthetic. Fits mine. The universe fits mine. So,
well, you know what we'll have to do? Yes. All right. So anybody who sees the show that Gigi is the lighting director for, tag Trent Reznor in it and Gigi, and then maybe we can all make that work.
Yeah, he does have the perfect team, though, you know?
Yeah, well.
Trent Reznor always work with the best, so his creative team and his LDR are the best. I don't see why he would call me, but well, maybe in the future.
Yeah, well, exactly. You know what? Everybody needs a new inspiration every once in a while, so.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, Gigi, promise I will let you go. Thank you so much for spending some of your time with me. I know you get very few days off, so I really do appreciate it.
No problem. Thank you very much. Okay, well, let's keep in touch.
Definitely. Thank you so much. It was really awesome talking to you.
No problem. We'll talk back anytime. I have so many more things to see.